All right, and so we're just delighted to have these folks here to help us celebrate in this great time today. And then I want to introduce to you the Freedom House staff. And when I introduce to you people who are here on staff at Freedom House, as I introduce you guys, I want you to come up and stand right up here in the front. The first is Gary Smith. Gary hails from Brooklyn, Arkansas, and he's the Assistant Executive Director. Gary, right up here. And then his lovely wife, Susan, from Belleville, Illinois. She's an Assistant Executive Director. And then Amy Shook from Boonville, Mississippi. She's an Assistant Resident Director. Kent Anderson from Tuscaloosa, Alabama is an Assistant Resident Director. Brad Wentz from Paragould, Arkansas. And Brad is the Program Overseer. Or, no, he's not. He's a Senior Counselor. And then James McNulty from Longmont, Colorado is the Program Overseer. Gerald Gillantine from Golden, Mississippi is the Assistant Counselor. And then Anna Soretti, is Anna here? Anna is the Dean of Counselors, and she's from Fort Lauderdale, Florida. And what I want us to do right now is we're going to pray for these folks. I want our elders to come, and we just want to kind of put your hands on some of these folks, and we're going to pray for them. And just ask God to bless them. And David McCormick, who is one of our elders, is going to lead this prayer for us. So are we all here? Here we come. All right. In your best outside voice, David.
Go up and just bow with me, please. Yes. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, Lord. And we thank you for this staff that you've assembled to do your work. Lord, we just ask that you just bless them with your guidance and your wisdom. And know that they are going to need your mercy and your grace also during this undertaking. Lord, we just want to lift them up to you, and we want you to give them the knowledge and wisdom that they need to make the decisions that they'll have to make. This is not an easy task, Lord, and they've chosen to do it. And we just are so thankful that they have given of themselves to better your kingdom. Lord, because we know that the addictions that these people are fighting is real. It's Satan in the flesh, yeah, destroying lives, and these men and women have been willing to give up their own lives in order to help free those others of addiction. And Lord, we just ask all these blessings in your sweet and precious name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And amen. All right, let's give them a hand again as they go take their seats. Okay, now at this point, I want to introduce to you again Steve Schwartz, Executive Director of the Mission Teens Ministry. So, Steve, you come, and he's going to bring us greetings from the Ministry of Mission Teens. So let me find you a microphone here, Steve. There you go, brother. Amen. God bless you.
Now we're on. Greetings again. First of all, I want to thank Pastor Kenny and his wife and all the members of this church for the wonderful job that you've done helping the mission get settled in. I told him yesterday morning, if this is pioneering a mission, I want to be a pioneer. You know, they have everything they need over there to get started. And I want to talk a little bit about the mission and how it got started. I wanted to say, this morning, I'm a looker, you know. I watched the crowds, and I saw the crowds of people coming into the church, and I could see that there was a lot of people who were eager to help the people at the mission. And I wanted to tell you in advance that starting tomorrow morning, the mission's going to get started with their schedule, and it won't be the same as it was before tomorrow morning. So if you ask them to do something and they say no, they can't do it right now, please don't be offended by it. Please don't be offended by it, because they have a program to run, and if they don't run the program, the people won't change. So back in the 60s, our founder was a Methodist youth pastor, and he really had a burden on his heart for young people. And he got the youngsters involved in sports at the church and had a growing gathering all the time. And then he started a prayer meeting at his house for the real troubled youth to come by on Sunday nights and spend time and hear about Jesus and the love of Jesus. And the meeting got so big that the police shut it down. They said, you got too many people coming over here to your house. And so he cried out to the Lord, and he said, there has to be something more I can do to help the youth of this nation. And the Lord told him to start a mission. And he said, what is a mission? And he thought for a few years, that he was supposed to open up a coffee house or something similar to that. And just out of nowhere, he was looking through the want ads, and he saw a building for sale in Norman, New Jersey. And he said, I'm going to go look at this building. And he bought it, and he didn't know why he bought it. And he went to the Lord, and he said, what am I supposed to do with this big building? And the Lord said, fill it up. So he filled it up. He had retreats there, and really nothing was happening. They were preaching the word. They were having meetings, devos, and not a lot was going on. And so he went to the Lord again, and he said, there has to be something more. There has to be something more. And the Lord woke him up in the middle of the night, and he wrote 20 pages on pieces of paper, and that ended up being the program that we run today. And if you look at the program, there's really nothing spiritual about it. You know, you wake up. The number one rule is wake up and make your bed, you know. And but as soon as they started doing that, everybody started to change. And the word went out, and there was a young lady who stopped by to visit who was a young aspiring actress in New York City. And she went back and got on TV and told them about the mission in Norman, New Jersey, and that drug addicts were being set free there, heroin addicts. And a lot of people from New York City came. And from the first day, the Lord has been healing and setting drug addicts free, heroin addicts. You know, back in the 60s, there was a lot of hardcore drug addicts that came to the mission, and hardcore alcoholics, real hardcore, the kind you saw in the movies and the kind you were afraid of back in the 60s and the 70s. And through the years, everything kind of like evolved into, really honestly today, the hardcore drug addicts that we have are all addicted to prescription drugs that they were put on by doctors when in their youth going through school when they were just acting up. And instead of giving them a spanking, they gave them a pill. And instead of sitting them down and telling them you can't do this, disciplining them, they gave them a pill. And now that they're in their early 20s, they can't stop. And they haven't really gotten started in life. You know, a lot of our people just never got started. And so we have drug addicts, alcoholics, and people with emotional problems. And we have a lot of people who aren't from the street come to the mission. You know, they might even be from this church. Women who go in after having a child, or and the doctor says, how are you doing? And they actually say, well, this is how I'm doing. And the doctor starts them out on a little pill. You know, it's going to get worse with Obamacare and free insurance for everybody. Up where I come from in the Upper Peninsula, it's really an area of extreme poverty. And everybody has free insurance. They had it even before Obama. But after the Obamacare thing started, now, you know, we have doctors call us up and say, it's time to come in for this checkup and for that checkup, if you can believe it or not, they do. And when you go to the doctor, all they do is give you a slip of paper with a prescription on it. And it's, so it's going to get worse and worse and worse and worse. Back in the 60s, while Jim was a Methodist preacher, minister, he got filled with the Holy Ghost. He got the baptism of the Holy Spirit back when the move of the Spirit came through. Really, a lot more Catholics got the baptism of the Holy Spirit than anyone. And so he got the baptism of the Holy Spirit and was kicked out of his church at the same time. But The baptism of the Holy Spirit is a big part of Mission Teens. And if you read The Cross and the Switchblade, the book that David Wilkerson wrote, it talks about the baptism of the Holy Spirit in there and how it gives the power that you need to be set free and walk in freedom. And when David Wilkerson was writing the book, he thought, I better leave that out because I don't want to get everybody offended. And then before he got a chance to publish the book, the Lord told him, no, that without that, it's not as powerful. It's not as good without the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So they do have the baptism of the Holy Spirit next door, and I hope you're not offended by that either, or are afraid of it and speak in other tongues. And but we believe in the power of God and to set the captives free. But no one ever thought that 47 years later that we would have 17 centers throughout the United States. And we don't go around and just say we're going to move into this neighborhood or we're going to move into that neighborhood. The Lord invites us to come, and he sets everything up and provides all of our needs. And those are the only places that we go. That's why there's only 17 missions after all these years. And so this is a real move of God on this area and this part of the United States. And the Lord plans on covering every part of the United States. There's going to be a lot of people from the drug court and people that you're tired of sending to the county jail that you might want to give the people, you know, let's send them to the mission. And you may have to send them to one of the other missions after this one can only have so many people from the local before, you know, birds of a feather flock together and they'll start ganging up on the staff and telling them what to do. So this program really works. Everyone who is here, myself included, we work for free. We're volunteers. We don't get paid a nickel. And we've all come through the mission broken. And we found that the Lord set us free, delivered us, and gave us a new life. And there was no place, there was nothing else we could do. There was nothing else I could do. I could not go back to going to work and just forgetting about God. I said, whatever it is you want me to do the rest of my life, that's what I'll do. And this is, we all do it. All the directors here, all the staff members volunteer our time because we know that the program works. And I'm proud to be a part of Mission Teens, and I'm proud to be a part of what's going on here today in your church and with your people of Holcomb and Kennett and this part of Missouri and Arkansas that are interested in helping our children and our grandchildren be set free and get a new life and become the men and women that God called them to be. Somehow, we all lost track. We were all separated from the Lord. I was going to read a scripture out of the book of Hosea in chapter 6 where it says, come, let us return to the Lord. And so the Lord is calling us to all return back to the Lord. And he's using you and this church and that building next door and all the officials today who came, who are interested to set the captives free. Amen. The program's free. The program's free. You can't go anywhere for free anymore. So I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
All right. What a great bit of information from Mission Teens. Now, the next thing that we're going to do is we're going to hear from Susan Smith. Susan and Gary Smith are the directors at Freedom House. And Susan is going to tell us about a typical day at Freedom House. So you'll kind of have an idea of what's going to happen on the typical day over there. Why, as Steve said, which we've been kind of spoiled to doing, when we needed something done, we could just say, hey, Gary, can we have a couple of guys to help us do this? And that would happen just instantly. But that's over to a large degree.
To be honest, Hello. Okay. Thank you, everybody, for coming. The mission is very structured because when we were in the world, we did what we wanted to do when we wanted to do it, and we didn't care who we hurt or what we, who we stole from, who we lied to, who we cheated, to do what we wanted to do, and it was bad for us. So we have a very structured schedule. Whenever you enter Mission Teens, there's a time that you wake up. You have 30 minutes from the time you wake up to be up, dressed, have your bed made, and be ready for breakfast. Then we eat breakfast, and everyone does a 30-minute chore. The program works because everyone in the program runs the program. So even if you've only been there a day or a week, you're going to have a chore to help maintain the house. After chores, we're going to go into devotions in the morning for 30 minutes, and then we're going to have two class periods that are an hour long each, which is Bible training, because that's what's going to change you, is Jesus. And then we have a period of reading and counseling where you'll either be counseled and talk about your problems, and the counselors will guide you back to the Word and back to Jesus, or you will spend that hour reading the Word. We also do book reports. I don't know the exact statistics. Donna could probably help me, but I think through the program alone, your reading level increases like 3 grade levels. Is that right? 3 or 4? Just from doing the book reports. After that, you get a short break. That's whenever you see everybody run out and smoke cigarettes, because we deal with one problem at a time. But then we have lunch, and then after lunch, they do 2 hours of work projects. And that work project might be mowing the lawn, and it might be cleaning rocks. You'd be like, why would you clean rocks? Well, because you're going to talk to the Lord while you're doing that. And you're probably going to get mad at somebody for assigning you to it. And you're going to say how stupid it is. But by the time the 2 hours is over, you're probably going to be healed in some part of your heart. You know? My sister's here, and she, you know, was asking me about some of the rules. Like, you can't talk to the kitchen when you get your plate. Why can't you do that? And I'm like, well, some rules are just put in place to teach you to be obedient to them, you know, because we never had obedience in the world. So some things won't make sense to y'all, like, why do you do it that way? Some things we don't know why we do it that way, but we know it works. So after they do their 2 hours of work projects, we have 30 minutes of fellowship where they drink coffee or sodas or buy candy bars. We got like a little candy store, and then they all take their showers. They get like 5-minute showers. So it's very disciplined, and then they come into dinner. And after dinner, they do a short chore, and then we have devotions every night from 7:30 to 9 that are open to the public. And if anybody would ever love to come, we would love to have you there, and I'm sure you'll be blessed by it. And then after that, they get a snack, and they go to bed. And the next day, they get up, and they do the same thing over. And we do the same thing over and over. In the world, we did the same thing over and over, and we expected a different result, and it never came. In the mission, we do the same thing over and over, and it works, and it begins to create a change in our heart. You know, why do you got to make your bed? You got to make your bed because it's the right thing to do. You know, and whenever you stop making your bed, you stop reading your Bible, and then you start making other compromises, and then you're right back where you started from. So we try to get everyone to do what they're supposed to do every minute of every day. We promote accountability, because if you don't do what you're supposed to do now, you're not going to do it later, you know? So anyway, that's about a typical day at the mission. So praise the Lord.
All right, you know, Steve can tell us about Mission Teens, and Susan can tell us about a typical day at the mission, but what really helps is when you can put flesh and blood to that, and you can hear from somebody who's actually been through the program where they were and how God, by His grace, brought them to to a new place in life. And so we're going to hear from Amy Shook. Amy is going to tell us about that. So welcome her as she makes her way to the platform. You have a fan club, Amy.
Yeah, I think it's kind of exciting because I've been here for 2 months and all anybody sees is a smiling face and someone that talks about the Lord. And so I think it's kind of exciting for them to see where I've kind of been in my life. And I can tell you the last time I stood in front of prosecuting attorneys or judges or something, they were waiting to send me to prison. So praise the Lord, I am a life that's been changed and God seemed fit to do something different with my life. And you know, I think it's typical that everybody that comes through the mission has had rejection issues, they've lived in fear, they've it's either molestation or rejection, their parents divorced, and so I'm not really going to get into a lot of that. My parents divorced when I was 15, and I was raised in church. I didn't understand. My dad was a deacon, and he left my mom, and so at the very early age, I had the question of why God. And you know, I didn't understand at a very early age that God is a good God and the choices of people is the reason that things turn out bad. So I didn't understand any of that. So I took all those things in my life and I just kept pushing God away. And you know, and I thought he was somebody bad. I thought he was good to some people and he didn't love some people. I just, you know, I was really confused. So anyway, that's pretty typically how my life started. Went through high school, never drank, never did drugs, never went to a school party, anything. Married at a very early age, seeking acceptance because of my dad. I was longing for that fulfillment of a rejection. He left, when he left mom, he married this woman that had 3 kids, and like my dad bought their vehicles, and my dad did all these things and never had anything to do with us. There would be a year that I would never even see him. So that's kind of how my life really started. Married really early. I've got 2 boys. Hunter's 21. Casey will be 18 this year. Let's see. Really early, I married, went to work. Well, went to college, decided that I had a family to raise. I went to work. In 2002, still have never done anything, never drank, never experienced anything. I went through a divorce 3 years after marriage, remarried after 3 years on my 4th year. Got my pharmacy tech license in 2001, maybe. And the very first thing I ever experienced, and you know, I think for a long time I blamed him because it's like, well, if he would have never offered me that first pill, I wouldn't have ever been where I was. But you know, that was a lie, and I had to get before the Lord and forgive that man for even thinking that it was his fault. No matter what choices come our way, God's going to give us free will to make those choices. But after a long day of filling 400 scripts that day, I can remember going to his house, and he was like, I know you've had a long day, so here, take this. And it was a Percocet. So from that day, that was a cure to a silent killer of my life, of not feeling rejected, not feeling I was worth anything, and it was a heaven sin, I thought. And so from that time in 2002, I was going through my 2nd divorce, and life began to spiral downhill. We began to party, we began to drink. The girls in the pharmacy were all going through a divorce, just a mess. And so we were going to the bars all the time. We became nothing but a social fan club, you know, and didn't care about my kids anymore. I didn't care about life anymore. Didn't care about my family. And so in 2005, I got my first DUI. And because of the pharmacist that I worked for and who you know how that works, it got, no, let me take that back. It was in 2004 that I got my first one, but it was because of him knowing the judge, it got thrown out. 2005, I got another one. And so I only had to lose my license for 90 days, did the typical first DUI. So I tried to straighten my life up. I knew I was already spiraling out of control. I knew what it was like to already start doctor shopping. I knew what it was like to get prescription medication because the doctor gives it to us, you know. So by this time, I'm trying to get myself together because I'm realizing that things aren't going good in my life. But like I said, I tried. And in your own strength, you can't do anything. It doesn't matter how much you try to do things different until everything changes in your life. Eventually, it's going to come back the same. So in 2005, 5, I met this guy, and he moved in with me. We began a relationship that was physical and just another mess on top of my other mess. And in 2012, all that ended. I got another DUI. Long story short, when I get to the mission, I've had 4 DUIs from 2012 to 2013. 4 DUIs, 8 months apart. DUI, controlled substance, you name it. I mean, there was tickets miles long every time. And so I'm bound to the grand jury. I've got 5 DUIs on my record. And you know, just to sit here and look at me, I really should be sitting in prison. How I didn't kill myself or how I didn't kill somebody else, it was only the grace, protection, and mercy of God that he had over my life. So I go to court. Well, actually, I had a lawyer, and he was running for mayor. And so, another long story short, he hired another attorney, and he had taken over my case. Well, I had a court date, and that attorney didn't tell me that it was time for me to go to court. Well, he goes to court for me, and the judge is really tired of me, honestly. He's tired of seeing me, and he says, I don't care if she's here or not. I really don't care what y'all been going through. We're sentencing her here today. So my first sentence was 1 year in jail. They charged me with all 3 DUIs, 1 year in jail, tons of fines. And so when I can look back and tell you, when I really first began to realize that God was working in my life, on a Friday night, George Martin Vi calls my phone and he says, you know, Amy, he says, I don't know why I'm doing this. He said, but, and I know that but was God. He said, but if you'll be in court on Tuesday, we'll rehear your case. So I go to court on that Tuesday, and I meet with the prosecuting attorney, and I had a brand new vehicle, and the DA had gotten it in my last DUI charge. And he says, if you'll just sign your vehicle over to us, we won't bound you to the grand jury. And so I was like, okay, fine. It really didn't matter. So I signed my car over. And so I'm still got another grand jury case to go. And so he heard me that day. Well, he dropped one of my DUIs. So I've got 2 DUIs on my record for this time. He dropped my jail time down to 30 days. And that particular day, he says, Amy, do you not think you need rehab? And I was like, no, I'm good. I got this. After 4 DUIs, this is me. I'm stubborn, you know, and I thought I had this. But that's what so many people do. They think, you know, they can just do this on their own, or I can be clean for 30 days in jail and I'll be fine. But, you know, the truth of the matter, until the Lord empowers that Holy Spirit to resist the things that comes against us, nothing's going to change until you accept Jesus into your life. And so, anyway, I did my 30 days in jail in October of 2013. I went October the 13th. No, I went November the 10th to December the 10th, did my 30 days. First time I ever really spent more than 72 hours in jail, because my family was always right there to get me, you know. A lot of times family doesn't understand that they enable us by giving us exactly what we want, because until you've been given some discipline, you know, why should I change if somebody's always going to be right there to take care of me? So anyway, I got out of jail in December. By New Year's Eve, I'm in a crack house after spending 30 days. I'm in a crack house that's getting busted. And, you know, I was that Christian person that sits on the pew and they look out and they judge people and say, how can they? How is that person doing that? I was that person at a very young age and say, you know, I just don't understand, or why are they doing these things? But, you know, I ended up that person. And I ended up that person that was at that crack house New Year's Eve, and the law's coming in and raiding the place. Well, I run out because I'm scared, because I'm already in a lot of trouble and I'm waiting to go to grand jury. Well, I fell in a sewage and I laid there, and all these things happened and they never found me. And that was just another time that it was grace and mercy of the Lord, you know, protecting me. So I remember going home to my nana's. Here I have lost my home. I've had great jobs. I've had everything the world's ever thought, you know, was the world's society. I've had houses, cars, boats. I've had all these things. Those things doesn't give you happiness. They doesn't fulfill your life. And so, I lost my home. So I went to my nana's for 7 days, and I can remember laying in the bed. I can remember sending out texts. I can remember being so hopeless and saying, I really want to die. All I want to do is die. And literally, I don't think I ever thought about killing myself, but I really didn't care if I ever woke up. And I can remember my brother coming sitting beside me at the bed, and he was praying, and he's like, sister, if you don't change your life, he said, you're really going to die. And I was like, I know, but I didn't know how to. You know what? Sin is fun. Sin is, it gets an addiction on you, and you don't know how to change. Like, you want to so bad, but you don't know what to do. And so he began to pray with his pastor, and his pastor had a cousin that went through Restoration Ranch. And so let me tell you, this place called Freedom House that we're talking about, you may not know why you're doing some of the things that you're doing, or you may not be knowing why you're sending people there. This preacher didn't know why he was praying with my brother and telling him about Restoration Ranch, but it was for me. And Brother Kenny's been laying the groundwork for about a month and saying, you know what, the motives of our heart really doesn't matter why we do what we do. Because the motives of my heart was going to rehab, is what the world thinks it is a rehab over here. I thought I would go to rehab for a couple of months, and I thought I would make my family happy, and you know what, I would be okay and I would leave. Never in a million years did I ever go with the intentions of even completing a program, and I thought I just, you know, everything would be okay whenever I stayed just a couple months to be sober. So I go to the mission, and God really begins to work in my life. And I'll just tell you a couple things that's happened, because there's, in 2 years, I've been there since January the 14th, 2014, and there's so many pieces to the puzzle, and I could sit and talk to you all day long about the faith that God has given me in my life. I can tell you about so many pieces of the puzzle that God's brought me right here. But very early in the program, I went to this church meeting. It was February the 26th, right after I got there. And here I am. When I come to the mission, I was supposed to be in grand jury February the 23rd. And the prosecuting attorney said, if you'll go to the program and once you graduate, then we'll give you your court date for grand jury. And I was like, okay. So February the 26th, we went to a camp meeting. And this pastor wanted to know if he could prophesy over me. And I'm like, sure. Well, the only two things that he said to me was, what is your name and where are you from? And I told him my name was Amy and I was from Mississippi. And he said, okay. And so as he began to pray, he said, you know, he was praying for me. And he said, do you have court cases? And I was like, yes, sir. He's like, okay. He's like, you know, God is telling me if you will just be obedient to the calling that is in your life, that he's working to clear your record. And I didn't understand what any of that meant, but I knew that it was such a profound word from the Lord that I held on to that all through the program. And so I went through the program, and as God began to speak to me, this is where you're going to be. This is the ministry you're going to be in. I would fight tooth and nail. Lord, I have a son that's about to go to senior college. There's no way I can do this. You know, he even would take me to Jeremiah. He would take me to Genesis, said, you just be obedient. I'll take your offspring from nation to nation. My son graduated from junior college, got all sorts of scholarship. Ole Miss is paid for. The day that he graduated, he got a $22,000 scholarship to live on. I couldn't even fight with the Lord about that any longer. You know, it was things that we want to argue about out of disobedience to the Lord and say, but we can't. But, you know, he'll always show us, but I can. And so I graduated the program September the 27th, and the dean of counselor at the mission in Alabama and the overseers, everybody began to call my attorney. They began to call the prosecuting attorney in the county that I was in. And praise God, when they called them, there was no record to be found on Amy Shook. My record was clear September the 27th. Well, it was clear the day that God told that guy to tell me, you be obedient. But the thing about it is, I want you to pay attention to this. What if I hadn't been obedient? The same thing as Jim Bracken. What if he hadn't been obedient to do what God told him that night and started 17 sinners? And this is the main thing that these people will learn. If they truly want to change their life, they will be obedient, even in the times that they don't want to be. God spoke to me very early and said, surrendering your life and changing everything about you is doing everything that you don't want to do. So everything in my flesh didn't want to stay in mission teams. Everything in my flesh, did I want to come to Missouri or did I want to be a missionary for the rest of my life? No, probably not. But you know what? There's no greater joy and there's no fulfillment that pleases and satisfies my longing than to know that that person, we've got five people already in our house that have come off the street and sat right where I sat. you know, that were hopeless and didn't think there was change. But praise God, you know, look today, look at me. Romans 10:1 says, it says, our heart's desire should be for others' salvation. And that's what it's about at Freedom House. If one person changes their life, you know what? That's what God's called us to do. And I'm just so thankful. I'm thankful that God chose me to be a part of changing other people's life. Amen.
What a testimony to the grace of God. And you know, that's what it's all about. It's not about the Open Door Church. It's not about Freedom House. It's not about Mission Teens. Those are just tools in God's hands. It's about God's grace made available to the human race through the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what I want to do, I said I was going to do this in 10 minutes, but I don't think anybody else did theirs in 10 minutes. So, hey. Anyway, I want to talk to you about a series of visions, you know, that brought the Open Door Church from a little handful of people that decided there needed to be a contemporary church in Hawkins, Missouri, to reach a generation of people that weren't being reached by the more traditional churches. And from there to today, I just want to give you an overview of what God has done. What I really want to do is I just want to brag on Jesus for a little while to you. That's one of my favorite things to do. And so I just want to tell you about that. And also with that, I want to give honor to whom honor is due. Because Jesus does lots of things, but he never does anything without using people. Are you aware of that? He always uses people. And so I just want to honor some people today as I brag on Jesus. I'm going to start this little talk with a verse of scripture out of 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse number 1. And I'm sure that you've heard this before. Samuel wrote this, and it was a sad commentary on the days in which he lived. He wrote, "Now in those days, messages from the Lord were very rare, and visions were quite uncommon." What a sad day. Very few messages from the Lord, and as a result, very few visions to get anything done for the Lord. And so I want to talk about that. This statement written by Samuel was indeed a sad, sad commentary on the generation in which he lived. And the same thing could be written about our generation. What a sad day in which we live. Eli was serving as a high priest, and his wicked sons were serving as priests under his leadership. And the priest had become so wicked as the spiritual leaders of the nation that their influence on the nation had drawn the vast majority of Israelis away from God and his standards of righteousness. Does that sound kind of familiar? And then as the result, the Israelis were not expecting God to speak to them, and they weren't even interested in what he might have to say if he did speak. That sounds like contemporary America to me. And then as a result of the spiritual decline of the nation, God had stopped speaking to them. It was a period of time when God seldom offered his people messages, and as a result, they didn't have visions through the prophets. Samuel described that period in Israel's history when he wrote this text. In those days, messages from the Lord were very rare, and visions were quite uncommon. And here's what I can see from that. When I think about messages and visions, when the people of a nation turn their hearts away from God, he eventually stops speaking to them through his appointed spokesman, whether the prophets of the Old Testament or the pastors of the New Testament. And when God's people stop receiving messages from him, they eventually stop receiving visions as well. They don't know what it is that God wants to accomplish through them. There is no vision. God-given visions, you see, are directly related to his messages. And that fact is made very clear by Samuel's description of those times in which he lived. In those days, messages from the Lord were very rare. And what was the result? Visions were quite uncommon. I don't mean to be critical, but there are churches all over the country that their vision doesn't extend beyond trying to get enough people at church to keep the lights on. What a sad vision. Just keep the doors open. What a sad vision. I'll get carnal if I'm not careful, so you pray for me. Unfortunately, we too are living in a day when the vast majority of pastors are failing to present to God's people with clear, uncompromised passion messages from God. They are failing to unapologetically preach the word. And the significance of the consistent preaching of God's word is emphasized in Scripture by the Apostle Paul when he wrote to his young disciple Timothy. Of all the things that he wanted to say to Timothy at a real difficult time in Timothy's life, this is what he wrote to him in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse number 2. Preach the Word. Preach the Word of God. Be prepared whether the time is favorable or not. You know what that means? It doesn't matter whether people want to hear it or not. You preach it anyway. Preach the Word, whether the time is favorable or not. Patiently correct. I have trouble with that. Patiently. I'm ADD. There's no doubt about it. And I have trouble with that. Rebuke and encourage your people with good teaching. I think the real key to giving a church a message from the Lord and then that message resulting in a vision is not just a lot of fluff. It's not just a lot of 3 points in a poem. It's not just a lot of alliteration and all the stuff that people are doing today and calling it preaching. I want you to understand it's the uncompromised declaration of this is what God's Word says and this is what it means. God didn't stutter when He said it. This is exactly what it meant. It's good teaching. And so I want to spend the next few minutes giving you some of the visions that have resulted from just simple preaching of God's Word here at the Open Door Church. And as I said, I want to give honor to whom honor is due by telling you about this series of visions that God gave to basically three men. And Paul wrote this about the importance of giving honor. It's in Romans 13, 7. Render therefore to all their dues. In other words, give to everybody what they deserve in a positive sense. He said, give tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, and then honor to whom honor. So I want to honor some fellas today. In April of 2006, God began to form a vision in the heart of Kevin True, and I want to honor him today, along with about 15 other people. These folks were worshiping at the South Canaan General Baptist Church, and God began to stir in the heart of Kevin a vision to start a contemporary church in Hawkeye, Missouri, designed to reach a generation of youth and young adults who weren't being reached by the existing churches. And as a result, the Open Door Church was started on June 7, 2007, roughly 9 years ago. We wouldn't be here today if it weren't for the willingness of those people to pursue that vision until it became a reality. I want you to understand that. God can give the vision, but until we pursue the vision through to it becoming a reality, nothing happens. And so you got to understand that those people pursued the vision until it happened, and I honor them for that. And then when I became the pastor of the Open Door Church on January the 30th of 2010, I just started preaching messages from God's Word. I've been doing that since I was 17 years old. My kids say, Dad, you could get an honest job if you knew how to do anything else. But I really don't know that much else to do other than just preach the Word of God. And so, you know, I just began to emphasize His will for His church to be outward focused rather than inward focused. And I have to tell you, some of these folks that have been here for this ride for those 6 years or so that I've been here, it was a real strain in the beginning. Would some of you wave and say, you're right, Pastor, and it was a strain this morning. It's still been a strain, you know, but it's happened. It was just a change in focus toward being outward focused. And as a result of that new direction of being outward focused, I want to honor another man. God used this guy named Jason Smith to give our elders this vision. I wish all of you knew Jason Smith. He is so much like his dad, who is here today too and a member of our church. It is scary. And there's a third generation coming on fast, and that's even scarier. You know, I mean, I'm telling you that God gave Jason this vision that he shared with our elders, the vision of reaching out to our community by launching what is today the Open Door Church's food pantry and clothes closet ministries. Jason said something like this during an elders ministry. He said, we need to find a way to reach outside the walls of our church and impact our community. And so after some discussion, we decided that a practical way we could do that was to launch the food pantry and clothes closet ministries. And as a result, on August the 4th of 2012, those ministries were open to the public for the very first time. And since that day, 57 people have prayed to receive God's incredible gift of eternal life from those ministries. And I just have to say to Jason, That's 57 people in heaven, Jason, that wouldn't maybe be going that way if it weren't for the vision that God gave him and he shared with us. And then this church was willing to follow through with that. And you know, sometimes people squirm a little bit because we spend a lot of money buying food and giving it away. But I want you to understand something. 57 people are going to heaven because of that. And that's what it's supposed to be all about. And so it's just a vision, and that was just another step toward bringing us to where we are today. And I'm so glad that God gave that vision, because without it, those people might have perished. Wise King Solomon wrote this in Proverbs 29:18, where there is no vision, what happens? The people perish. Where there is no vision, the people perish. And then about 9 months later, it was May the 10th, 2013, God used Jason again. You know, if he ain't got much to work with, I mean, what can you say? He used him again. So God used Jason again to give our elders the vision of launching another outreach ministry. And that ministry is what we know today as Freedom House. You see, at an elders meeting, Jason said something like this, and I'm not quoting, but the gist of it's here. He said, we need to try to do something so big that when people see it, they'll conclude that we couldn't have done it. God must have done it. What a great philosophy. If your dream is only as big as something you can do, your dream is way too small. It needs to be bigger than you could possibly do. Then God gets the credit for it. And as the discussion progressed, it became apparent to the elders that the big thing that we needed to try to do was to use the house that at that time we called the Big House to open a ministry dedicated to evangelizing and discipling men and women who were enslaved by drugs and alcohol. We said this. We said, you know, Jesus reached out to the people that were the most vulnerable, and the devil was destroying to the greatest degree in his culture. You know, he reached out to the tax collectors and the prostitutes and, you know, those folks that were at the very lowest ebb of the social strata of his day. And we need to be reaching out to those people. So who are those people today? And it was like, there's no question about it. It's the addicts and the alcoholics. Those are the folks that the devil is destroying today in our culture. Those are the folks that are the tax collectors and prostitutes of our day. And so we need to be reaching out to them. And so a little over 2 months later, on July the 21st, 2013, we decided to partner with Mission Teens as a strategic step toward transforming that vision into a reality. And the leaders of Mission Teens agreed to enter into this ministry partnership with our church and open their 17th facility. And we named this ministry center Freedom House because of a statement made by Jesus to some Jewish Christians. It's recorded in John 8:32. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. That's our theme verse. You'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And that's why at the Mission Teens program and here at Freedom House, that's why they spend about 5.5 hours a day in the Word in one fashion or another, because the Word is the Word of truth, and it's only truth that'll set people free. It's not our programs, and it's not our earnestness, and it's not our intelligence, and it's not our talent, and it's not all of that. It's simply the truth of the Word of God that sets people free. That's what Jesus said. Our elders realized that in order to open this facility to minister to addicts and alcoholics, we would need to construct a building to house our church's ministry and children's ministry and our food pantry and our clothes closet. So we began making plans for a new building. You see, the children's ministry and the food pantry and the clothes closet was in that house. And I'm telling you, it was a circus over there trying to do all of that in that house. Some of you remember that. And so we knew that we had to build a building. And at that point, God gave me a little vision. I love it when God gives other people the vision first and then gives me one a little later, and only could give me one because they already had one, you know? And so he gave me this little vision about this building, and the vision was constructing a debt-free building. And I just began to beat the drum for that. Yep, we need to do this, but we're not going any further in debt. We're way too far in debt as it is, and so we're not going to go in debt any further. It's going to be a debt-free building. I reasoned like this. If God provides the resources up front to accomplish all of this, it'll be obvious to everyone that it is indeed his will. And you know, I learned this a long time ago reading books, autobiographies of guys like George Mueller and Hudson Taylor. You know what I learned from them? God always pays for what he orders, you know? And he pays for it up front. Now, I know, you know, we make mistakes and we go in debt, and I know that God blesses and honors and, you know, in spite of us most of the time. Would you agree with that? I'm so glad that God blesses in spite of me and instead of because of me. Oh, man, it wouldn't be much. So I had no idea how God would provide the funding, but I was sure that he would. And he kept reminding me that both the tabernacle and the temple, the two building projects that are outlined for us in Scripture, were both constructed with resources provided by God up front. No debt. Both of them were that way. I don't think God was just wasting his time when he put those stories in there. I think there's lessons to be learned from that. So, no debt was incurred in either of those building programs. And then we said, if God wants it, God will do it. And while we were still in the planning stages for the new building, God used another one of our men, David McCormick, to give our elders the vision of securing the ownership of a building in Hockham that was being vacated by the First Baptist Church. David envisioned housing our food pantry and our clothes closet ministries in that building. That would mean that we didn't have to build quite so big a building over here if we could do that. And so David and Jason contacted the leaders of the First Baptist Church, and through a series of events that only God could have orchestrated over the next several weeks, the congregation of the First Baptist Church generously donated their facility to the Open Door Church. It's a big church building and a parsonage, and we rent out the parsonage, and it pays the utilities and the insurance on the other building. And so today we own that building. On September the 9th, 2014, we assumed ownership of that building, which meant that our new building would only have to house our children's ministry. And today, that First Baptist Church facility houses our food pantry and our clothes closet ministries, and only God could have orchestrated that, because, kind of crossing denominational lines and crossing age, generation gaps and all that stuff, and a group of really senior saints decided to give a group of kind of young, reckless people in this new church their property. I almost fainted when it actually happened. That's how little faith I have, But God did that. God worked all that out. And then a few months passed, and the Mako Corporation contacted Kevin True, with an offer to either trade some of our land here or maybe purchase some land from us. And God began to stir Kevin's heart, and God soon used Kevin to give our elders another vision, the vision of using the sale of some of our excess acreage to fund a major portion of the construction of this new building. And the deal was made, and Kevin handled the legal paperwork, and then in March 2015, through the sale of 7.5 acres of land, God provided $30,000 for our new building. The Moark Mission Board that I recognized earlier, they donated $8,000 total toward that project. And then the Blue Cane Church, and some of those folks are here today, and I'm so glad they're here, they donated $1,000 toward the construction of this building, and also gave about $745 to Freedom House to help with their operating expenses, and I honor them for that. And then the members of this church, and listen, we're not a rich church, but the members of this church, since the beginning of the vision of this project, the members of this church have contributed $58,860 out of their own pockets to make this a reality. And as a result, on Wednesday evening, February the 10th of 2016, our children's ministry moved into this new 3,200 square foot debt-free building at a cost of $97,860. Only God could do that in the boot heel of Missouri. So we are here today to celebrate all that God has done through this series of visions to make the ministry of Freedom House a reality. And I am personally thrilled that messages are not rare and visions are not uncommon at the Open Door Church in Hockham, Missouri. I am thrilled about that. Now here's a conclusion. You can breathe deeply now, because that means we're almost done. I know that's your favorite word in the whole sermon, conclusion. I want to conclude by sharing with you my personal pastoral vision for Freedom House. It's made up of three basic components. First one is that I envision clearly sharing the good news with every resident of Freedom House so they can believe it and receive the incredible gift of eternal life. I'll do that as I teach classes over there, and I'll do that on Sunday mornings as I preach to the residents. Jesus said this. He said, go into all the world and preach the good news to everyone. Only difference between that and what we're doing at Freedom House, instead of us going to them, we're bringing them to us, and we'll just preach to them the good news that God loves them and Jesus saved them if they'll only believe in him. And then I envision helping Gary and Susan recruit high-quality Bible teachers who can effectively disciple every resident of Freedom House. Because Jesus said, go and make disciples. It's not enough to just get them saved. It's not enough just to make converts. He wants disciples of all nations. And we have some of those teachers here. If you've been recruited and you're going to teach at Freedom House, would you stand up and let us honor you? Would you just kind of, you guys stand up? I know some of you are here. I see you. You're going to teach or preach at Freedom House. Mark, you're here. Okay. So these guys are here, and there are several more. There's Barbie over there. There are several more that are going to be doing that. And then the third thing is that I envision creating an environment of worship at Freedom House where every resident is encouraged to worship in spirit and in truth. We got a little taste of that over the last few days when they had their worship services. And Jesus said this in John 4:24, God is spirit, so those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. Worship is simply expressing from your heart the worth of God. It's exactly what it is. It's telling him how good he is, how valuable he is, how awesome he is, how incredible he is. It's expressing from your heart his worth. And when you do that, God shows up, because the scripture says that he inhabits the praise, the worship of his people. Thank you for letting me rattle on like this. It has been a real joy, a real privilege to be here. And we're going to close out our service.